THE LITTLE MINISTER by J. M. Barrie. CHAPTER 42. MARGARET, THE PRESENTER, AND GOD BETWEEN. Unless Andrew Luke, who went to Canada, be still above ground, I am now the only survivor of the few to whom Lang Tammas told what passed in the manse parlour after the door closed on him and Margaret. With the years the others lost the details, but before I forget them, the man who has been struck by lightning will look at his arm without remembering what shriveled it. There even came a time when the scene seemed more vivid to me than to the presenter, though that was only after he began to break up.
"She was never the kind of woman," Whamond said,
"that a body need be nine feared at. You can see she is the timid sort. I couldna hae selected a woman easier to speak bold out to, though I had hind my pick o' them."
He was a gaunt man, sour and hard, and he often paused in his story with a puzzled look on his forbidding face.
"But, man, she was so meek they windy of him. If he had wanted to put a knife into her, I believe that woman would just hae telled him to take care no to cut his hands. Aye, and what innocent like she was. If she had heard enough afore I saw her to make her uneasy, I could hae begun at once. But here she was, shaking my hand and smiling to me, so that I, when I tried to speak, I gied through hither. Nobody can despise me for it, I tell you, mair than I despise mysel. I thocht to mysel, let her hae her smile out. Tammas, Whamond, it's her hinmost. Syne with shame at my cowardliness, I tried to yoke to my duty as chief elder of the kirk, and I said to her, as strong as I could speak, 'Dinna thank me, I've done nothing for you.' 'I ken it wasna for me you did it,' she said, 'but for him. But oh, Mr. Whamond, will that make me think the less o' you? He's my all,' she says, with that smile back in her face, and a look mixed up wi' it that said as plain, 'and I need no more.' I thought o' saying that some builds their house upon the sand, but daggone it, dominie, it's a solemn thing the pride mithers has in their laddies. I mind, it's my ain mither. What the devil are you glowering at, Andrew Luke? Do you think I'm greeting?' 'You'll sit down, Mr. Whamond,' she says next. 'No, I winna,' I said angry like. 'I dinna come here to sit.' I could see she thought I was shy at being in the manse parlour. Aye, and I thought she was pleased at me looking shy. Well, she took my hat out of my hand, and she put it on the chair at the door, where there's aye an auld chair in grand houses for the servant to sit on at family exercise. 'You're a man, Mr. Whamond,' says she, 'that the minister delights to honour, and so you'll oblige me by sitting in his own armchair.' Gavin never quite delighted to honour the presenter, of whom he was always a little afraid, and perhaps Margaret knew it. But you must not think less of her for wanting to gratify her son's chief elder. She thought, too, that he had just done her a service. I never yet knew a good woman who did not enjoy flattering men she liked.
'I saw my chance at that,' Whamond went on, 'and I says to her sternly, in worldly position, I says, I'm a common man, and it's no for the like as it's to sit in a minister's chair. But it has been God's will, I says, to wrap around me the mantle of chief elder of the kirk, and if the minister falls awa frae grace, it becomes my duty to take his place. If she had been looking at me, she maun hae grown feared at that, and syne I could hae gone on, though my ilka word was a knock-down blow. But she was picking some things aff the chair to let me down on't.
It's a pair of mittens I'm working for the minister,' she says, and she handed them to me.
I tried not to take them. But, oh, lads, it's queer to think how saft I was.
'He's no to ken about them till they're finished,' she says, terrible fond like. The words came to my mouth, 'They'll never be finished,' and I could ha' cursed myself for no saying them. I dinna ken how it was, but there was something pitiful in seeing her take up the mittens and begin working cheerily at one, and me kenning all the time that they would never be finished. I washed her fingers, and I said to myself, 'Another stitch in that mon be your last.' I said that to myself till I thought it was the needle that set it, and I wondered at her no hearing. 'In the tail of the day,' I says, 'you need not bother, he'll never wear them.' And they sounded sich words of doom that I rose up off the chair. Aye, but she took me up her hand, and she said,
I see you've noticed how careless eyes, how incomforts he is, and that in his zeal he forgets to put on his mittens, though they may be in his pocket all the time. Oh, she says, confident like, but he winna forget these mittens, Mr. Woman, and I tell you the reason. It's because they're his mother's work.
I stamped my foot, and she gave me an apologetic look, and she says,
I cannot help boasting about his being so fond of me.
My, but here was me saying to myself, do your duty, Thomas Woman. You sluggard, do your duty, and without lifting my ain friar fingers, I said sternly, the chances are, I said, that these mittens will never be worn by the hands they are worked for.
You mean, she says, that he'll carry them away to some ill-off body, as he carries near a thing he has. Ay, but there's one thing he never parts with, and that's my work. There's a young lady in the monster now, says she, that offered to finish the mittens for me, but he would value them less if I let ony other body put a stitch into them.
I thought to myself, Thomas Woman, the Lord has opened the door for you, and you'll be disgraced forever if you dinna walk strapped in. So I rose again, and I says boldly this time, where's that young lady? I hae something to say to her that canna be kept waiting.
She's up the stair, she says, surprised, but you canna ken her, Mr. Woman, for she just came last night.
I ken mair o' her than you think, says I. I ken what brocht her here, and ken wha she thinks she is to be married to, and I've come to tell her that she'll never get him.
How no?
She said, amazed like. Because, said I, with my teeth together, he is already married. Lads, I stood waiting to see her fall, and when she didna fall, I just waited longer, thinking she was slow in taking it all in.
I see you ken wha she is, she said, looking at me. And yet I canna credit your news.
They're true, I cries.
Even if they are, says she, considering, it may be the best thing that could happen to both of them.
I sank back in a chair in fair bewilderment, for I dinna ken at that time, as we ken now, that she was thinking of the yarl when I was thinking of her son. Dominie, it looked to me as if the Lord had opened the door to me and syne shut it in my face. Shine with me sitting there in a kind of awe at a woman's simpleness, she began to tell me what the minister was like when he was a bairn, and I was saying all that time to myself, you're chief elder of the kirk, Thomas Woman, and you maun speak out the next time she stops to draw breath.
They were terrible, small, common things, she told me. She just near a mither's mind about their bairns, but the kind of holy way she said them drove my words down my throat, like as if I was some infidel man trying to break out with blasphemy in a kirk. I'll let you see something, says she, that I ken will interest you. She brought it out of a drawer, and what do you think it was? As sure as death, it was no more than somebody's hair when he's a littenin', and it was tied up such carefully in paper that you I thought it was some valuable thing. Mr. Woman, says she solemnly, you've come thrice to the manse to keep me from being uneasy about my son's absence, and you was the chief instrument under God in bringing him to Thrums, and I'll gie you a little o' that hair.
Dagone it, what did I care about his hair, and yet to see her fondling it.
I says to myself, Mrs. Dishart, I says to myself, I was the chief instrument under God in bringing him to Thrums, and I've come here to tell you that I'm to be the chief instrument under God in driving him out of it.
Aye, but when I fucked to bring out these words, my mouth snapped like a box. Dinna gie me his hair, was all I could say, and I would not take it fra her. But she laid it in my hand, and syne, what could I do? Oh, it's easy to speak about thy things now, and to wonder how I could hae so disgraced the position of chief elder of the kirk. But I tell you, I was near greeting for the woman. Call me names, Dominie, I deserve them all. I did not call woman names for being reluctant to break Margaret's heart. Here is a confession I may make. Sometimes I say my prayers at night in a hurry, going on my knees indeed, but with as little reverence as I take a drink of water before jumping into bed, and for the same reason because it is my nightly habit.
I am only pattering words I have by heart to a chair then, and should be as well employed writing a comic Bible. At such times I pray for the earthly well-being of the presenter, though he has been dead for many years. He crept into my prayers the day he told me this story, and was part of them for so long that when they are only a recitation, he is part of them still.
She said to me, the woman continued, that the women of the congregation would be fond to handle the hair. Could I tell her that the women was waur agin him than the men? I shivered to hear her.
Syne, when they're a sitting breathless listening to his preaching, she says, they'll be able to picture him as a bairn, just as I often do in the kirk myself.
Andrew, look, you're sneering at me, but I tell you, if you had been there and had begun to say he'll preach in our kirk no more, I would have struck you, and I'm chief elder of the kirk.
She says, oh, Mr. Whamon, there's times in the kirk when he is praying, and the glow on his face is hardly mortal, so that I fall a-shaken with a mixture of fear and pride, me being his mother. And sinful though I am to say it, I cannot help thinking at such times that I ken what the mother of Jesus had in her heart when she found him in the temple.
Dominie, it's sax and 20 years since I was made an elder of the kirk. I mind the day as if it was yestreen. Mr. Carfrae made me walk home with him, and he took me into the manse parlour, and he set me in that very chair. It was the first time I was ever in the manse. Aye, he little thought that day in his earnestness, and I little thought myself, in the pride of my lusty youth, that the time was coming when I would swear in that reverenced parlour. I say swear, Dominie, for when she had finished, I jumped to my feet, and I cried, Hail! And I lifted up my hat, and I was chief elder. She fell back frae my oath, he said, and syne she took my sleeve and speared, What has come over you, Mr. Whamon? Have you anything on your mind?
I've sin on it, I roared at her. I have neglected duty on it. I am one of them that cries, Lord, Lord, and yet do not the things which he commands.
He has pointed out the way to me, and I hinna followed it.
What is it you hinna done that you should ha' done? She said. Oh, Mr. Whamon, if you want my help, it's yours.
Your son's out of earth to you, I cried, but my eldership's as muckle to me. Saxon, 20 years I'd been an elder, and now I mun gie it up. Who says that? She spears. I say it, I cried. I've shirked my duty. I gie up my eldership now. Thomas Whamond is no langer an elder of the kirk. I and I was chief elder. Dominie, I think she began to say that when the minister came home, he wouldna accept my resignation, but I paid no heed to her. You ken what was the sound that kicked my ears frae her words? It was the sound of a machine coming yont the tenements. You ken what was the sight that made me glare through the window instead of looking at her? It was the sight of Mr. Dishart in the machine. I couldna speak, but I got my body atween her and the window, for I heard shouting, and I couldna doubt that it was the folk cursing him. But she heard too, and she squeezed by me to the window, and I could not look out. I just walked saft-like to the parlour door, but afore I reached it, she cried joyously, "He's my son, come back and see how fond of him they are. They are running at the side of the machine, and the laddies are tossing their bonnets in the air." God help you, woman, I said to myself. It cannot be bonnets. It's the stines and divots mair likely that they're flinging at him. Syne, I creeped out of the manse. Dominie, you mind, I passed you in the kitchen, and didna say a word?
Yes, I saw the presenter pass through the kitchen with such a face on him as no man ever saw him wear again. Since Thomas Whamon died, we have had to enlarge the Thrums cemetery twice, so it can matter not at all to him, but little to me, and what you who read think of him. All his life children ran from him. He was the dourest, the most unlovable man in Thrums. But may my right hand wither, and may my tongue be cancer-bitten, and may my mind be gone into a dry rot before I forget what he did for me and mine that day. End of chapter 42.